Hello guys, welcome back to my channel. My name is Nicholas. If you haven't already met me, I'm currently a foundation year 2 doctor in the UK. And today we're gonna be talking about oxygen delivery devices. Woohoo! So oxygen is one of the most commonly prescribed medications in the hospital. And if you've ever been to the hospital, you might be wondering, what are all these weird and wonderful devices that the patients are on? So my role today is to give you guys a brief overview on the common oxygen delivery devices that you will be able to find on a normal hospital ward. So oxygen is really important for our bodies because it is required for our cells and our organs to work. And there are many different reasons why a patient's oxygen requirements might go up in the hospital when they are critically ill. And therefore, these ill patients would need supplemental oxygen to meet the demands of their increasing oxygen requirements when they're unwell. Now, during the course of this video, you will be hearing me mentioning this term FiO2 quite a lot. For those who don't know what FiO2 is, it's basically the fraction of inspired oxygen. So the atmosphere around us is filled with a mixture of gases. It's about 78% nitrogen, 21% oxygen, and about 1% of the other gases such as carbon dioxide and also hydrogen. So let's say if you're out on a walk on a normal day, breathing normal atmospheric gas, the amount of oxygen that will be entering your lungs is about 21%, and that's the FiO2. So let's move on to the show and tell. So the first oxygen device here I have is the nasal cannula, also known as the nasal specs. If you can't remember any of those, it's basically the two prongs that get stuck into your nose. It has a flow rate of about 1 to 4 liters of oxygen per minute with an FiO2 of about 24% to about 36%. I can't believe I'm doing this for you guys. I'm like a sacrificial lamb. So basically, this is the most common airway device that you see in the hospital. It goes into your nose, loops around the ears like this. Then you have the port here that attaches to the oxygen. Advantages of having a nasal cannula in is you will be able to deliver oxygen, and the patient has the freedom to talk, eat, or also drink at the same time. The disadvantages of having a nasal cannula in is firstly, your nose is very highly vascularized, and that is to help with humidification of air. Basically, if you're running lots of dry air into the nose, it dries out the nose and all these blood vessels would tend to be fragile and might burst, causing nosebleeds. Also, if you have patients with blocked nose or have a surgery in the nose or have polyps obstructing the airway there, there's no point putting a nasal cannula in. And also, if you do have patients who breathe solely from their mouth, there isn't a point putting a nasal cannula in because the oxygen is flowing into here, and if your patient goes it's not going to be that effective if he's breathing through their mouth and the oxygen is going into their nose. Now the next mask that we have here is the simple face mask, alright? The flow weight for this mask is about 4 to 10 liters. You can squeeze it up to 15 liters, and the fraction of inspired oxygen in this mask is about 35% to 50%. You can push it up to about 60% with the 15 liters of gas flowing through per minute. It does have some ports and holes here to allow for carbon dioxide to escape. Some people would say a minimum of 6 liters per minute of oxygen running through this mask, to actually flush out the carbon dioxide that's coming out of your mouth, so that you would prevent yourself from, or prevent the patient from re-breathing in the carbon dioxide that's coming out from the mouth. The most important thing of the face mask is your patient, it covers your nose and your mouth, but you should have a good tight seal around the nose and the mouth so that the patient would not be getting the atmospheric air seeping or entraining into the oxygen flow that's coming in. If not, it will decrease your fraction of inspired oxygen. Sometimes these masks come with attachment to attach things like the nebulizer to give the patient some medication, and that's where the oxygen is being put in over here. Now the benefits of a simple face mask sometimes, or a nebulizer mask, is that you get a higher flow of oxygen as compared to the nasal specs, and therefore a higher of infection inspired oxygen, but you can't really eat or drink or talk much with the mask coming on and the oxygen flowing into the mask, creating a lot of sound.
It's also good to know that if you are actually running some medications through the nebulizer, you know, in my experience, we'll normally set the flow rate to about 4 to 6 liters, just because any higher or any lower, the aerosol that the oxygen is generating with the medication, it's not going to be effective in getting into the lungs.
So the next mask that we have here is known as the Venturi mask. It's basically a simple face mask with a colored insert here. The interesting thing about the Venturi mask, it is able to deliver a fixed rate of fraction of inspired oxygen. So depending on the insert, this shows here 4 liters a minute of oxygen, and it's able to provide you 28% of oxygen fixed. Now the reason why we have all these fixed performance device is because, as I said earlier, oxygen is a medication, alright? There are risks and benefits on delivering oxygen, and in some patients, over-oxygenation can actually lead to detrimental effect. However, if you're a medical student or a junior doctor watching this, if you have a patient who is acutely desaturating and unwell, don't be thinking about using a Venturi mask, because hypoxia is the first that kills. So anyway, the key takeaway of a Venturi mask, it gives doctors a fine tune and control in terms of oxygen delivery in fraction of inspired oxygen. All right, so the last mask that we have here is the mother of all masks. It's known as the non-rebreather mask, or basically if you see someone in this in the hospital, they're basically not doing too well. The ideal flow rate for this mask is 15 liters of oxygen per minute, and that's probably the highest you can actually give on the ward level. And ideally, it should be delivering 100% of FiO2 to the patient, but due to factors such as mask fit and room air mixing, it normally delivers from about a range of 60% to about 85% of FiO2. So if you ever found this mask a wee bit familiar, you know, it's one of those masks that's used in the aircrafts, you know, when there's low oxygen, it just poops, comes down in the middle of nowhere and you have to put it on. Yes, it's kind of one of those masks, but slightly upgraded. So the functions of this mask here, you do have the oxygen port coming in, oxygen travels in, fills up the reservoir bag. There are valves in the mask here, one-way valves that's only allowing oxygen from traveling in the bag up to the patient for inhalation, and when the patient exhales the air, a one-way valve that only allows air from coming out of the patient and prevent room air from coming in. Small tip for the medical students who are about to do the OSCEs, or the junior doctors who's first time using these masks, when you insert the oxygen, you'll realize that the reservoir bag doesn't fill out by itself. Now the thing you need to do is you have to cover the one-way valve in the mask here, okay, to allow filling of the air of the reservoir bag, so it looks something like this. So that's when the reservoir bag fills up, okay? You have to cover the wee valve here for it to work. Right, so I'm just gonna talk a bit about the airway adjuncts for the junior doctors or the medical students, or if you're just curious in what these are, stay with me for the next few minutes. So sometimes in an acutely unwell patient and you've put on the non-rebreather mask, you find that the patient's still desaturating, starting to lose consciousness. First thing you would do if you're worried about their airway is a head tilt chin lift to try and open up the airways. But if that's not working, that's when you're thinking of introducing airway adjuncts. But of course, if you're a junior doctor, call for help first before doing any of these, because you probably need a senior help or someone more experienced to help you with someone who is actually gonna have an airway compromise. The first airway adjunct I'll be talking about is the Goodell airway, okay, also known as the oropharyngeal airway. Now the reason for putting this in is when patients are slightly unconscious
or getting a bit weak, sometimes the tongue slides at the back of the throat there and obstructs the airway. So the purpose of putting this in, it sits at the base of the tongue there and prevents the tongue from sliding back and obstructing the airway. It comes in different sizes and different colors. Now, there are some indications where you wouldn't be using the oropharyngeal airway, especially when a patient is actually very conscious and have an intact gag reflex. Because if you can imagine, someone who's actually just had his lunch, put this in and he goes all of the content in his stomach is gonna go up into the lungs and it's gonna cause you much more trouble. Now, if the Goodell is not an option, the other option that you have is the nasopharyngeal tube. Basically, it goes into the nose. I don't have it with me here. Goes into the nose, stays at the back of the nose or at the base of the tongue there. It's better tolerated as compared to the Goodell, but some of the contraindications of putting a nasopharyngeal tube in, if the patient has a nasal polyp that's blocking the nose, it's not going to go in. If the patient had nasal surgeries, they might have a different anatomy. Or if a patient actually has a basal skull fracture, you don't want to be introducing anything into the nose and cause more damage. The last and final device that I want to show you guys is the Igel. This is a supraglottic airway device, and I've learned how to use it during my medical school days when I was attached to the anesthesia department. And I've also learned how to use it during my advanced life support training. Basically, this is my last resort, my last go-to. If I have an acutely unwell patient here, about to lose his airway, doing everything that I can't really get any oxygen in, desaturating, calling for help, but help isn't here yet. Basically, the Igel is a device that sits at the laryngeal inlet. It has been said that in use in the hands of a well-trained professional, it takes about 5 seconds to get that in to actually help oxygenate a patient. It has a good function. So the functions that an Igel has is a bite block here. So when patients start biting on it, it doesn't compress the tube and still allows oxygen to flow through. It also has a wee port here, and that's to allow an insertion for an NG tube to allow suction of abdominal contents if needed. And this is also where the oxygen delivery device has been attached here to deliver oxygen to the patient. So yeah, I haven't managed to use this at all during any of my acute emergencies. I don't really want to use this because this is my last go-to if everything else fails and help is not here yet. It comes in different sizes and also different colors for different patients. So we have come to an end of our show and tell today. I hope you guys have actually enjoyed yourself. If you like what I do, please give me a like and subscribe. If you want to follow me on Instagram, that's also fine by me. If not, have a great day ahead and hope you enjoy yourselves.